right, you guys, so let me introduce you to the cast of Suicide Squad. First up, we've got Adewale Akinoye Agbaji.
Yo. Woo!
We've got, yes!
Yeah, what's up, baby?
Adam Beach up next.
Yeah!
Jared Leto. I like that Will is just cheering for everybody. Jared Leto's joining us. Next up, Mr. Will Smith. Viola Davis. And we've got Joel Kinnaman. And we've got, on that end, producer Richard Suckel. Cara Delevingne is with us. Jay Hernandez. And our director, of course, we've got David Ayer with us. Margot Robbie. Hi, Courtney with us. Karen Fukuhara. Got producer Chuck Roven. I'm gonna start off the questions, you guys. So there's so much hype surrounding this movie. What is it like for you guys, the actors, director, producer, bringing these characters to the big screen and balancing what comic book fans already know and what you guys wanted to bring to the characters?
I think Jared should go first since he had the hardest job on the whole movie.
For me, it was actually the role of a lifetime. I had so much fun playing the Joker. I could easily just play the Joker a couple more times and retire.
don't be like that, you know?
It was a blast, but you guys seemed like you were having all the fun on the movie.
We were really enjoying it. David Ayer has a very interesting process of getting actors into their characters.
Manipulation.
Manipulation, yes, yes. Manipulation, domination, torture, yeah. So we all got in a room and he had, you know, essentially is much more like therapy than it was, you know, a character creation. So we sat and we talked about our lives and, you know, we got really close as we, you know, our triumphs and tribulations and trials and then at the most opportune moment, Joel describes it best, that he would
completely betray us. And betray that trust. And he would get a very unique reaction. You know, like,
the secrets aren't getting disclosed out there, but it's a process. It's like a gymnasium for acting is the way I look at it. Mm-hmm. And it just kind of, I needed these guys to feel like they're best friends on camera. And, you know, when you're with your best friend, you share secrets. You talk about your inner life. There's a way you talk to a really close friend. And I wanted them to have that energy. And the fastest way to get there was to have them beat the hell out of each other, share their secrets, and otherwise,
That's also how you start a cult.
A cult,
we'd all show up for training and we'd be fighting, hurting each other. And next thing you know, David would show up.
Adam, what you were doing, I do not want to categorize that as training.
I was screaming, getting in character.
Adam was doing body squats, body weight squats like this. And he was going like,
They were hard. But what I wanted to say, David was a champ. He'd show up, train with us, beat us up. There was this moment he was sparring with Karen, and she got it in the nose. Back.
She her guard was open.
That's what he said to me after he punched me in the face. He said, "You gotta block your face, Karen."
Clearly, you guys.
It's true. It's true. It's my fault.
It never happened
again, though. Yeah.
That's true.
This man made me push so many weights and get big. And when I got to the size that he desired for Killer Croc, and I figured I was ready, he said, "Now you got to fight Karen." You know, and you look at the size of her, but
she beat
the crap out of Croc.
Yeah, I mean, I could go all out because Adewale's so big and strong, so I can just punch all the way.
Well, clearly you guys all really bonded on the set, and I know that our press have some great questions for you guys as well, so let's take our first one from right over there. What's your name?
Deborah.
What's your question?
Where is she? Deborah. For Margot, Will, and Jared, what was the most challenging aspect of making this movie, and was anybody mildly injured during any of the physical scenes or any mishaps during the physical?
Don't be like that.
Mild injuries.
Mild, yeah. When you're 47, no injury is a mild injury anymore. I tore my calf a couple of weeks in, and it was terrible. Is you do it doing nothing. Like I wasn't doing anything. We're sparring, and I stepped back to throw a shot, and my calf popped, and. You know, you could hear it. People could hear it, and everybody was like, "Ooh, there's that. That's not good. Whatever that sound was, is not a good sound." And then the doctor told me I was down for 6 weeks. So on a movie like this, 6 weeks clicks off or can click off at significant amounts of money that I wasn't going to pay for it. But it was really scary. To be in that position, I was like, oh my God, this opportunity, Suicide Squad having this chance, and maybe not going to be able to deliver the way I wanted to. But
Will soldiered on, and then I think 3 seconds later, Joel blew out his calf.
Yeah,
his
Joel, arm. Yeah.
Same. It's just I was just trying to show sympathy.
Sympathy. It was like a sympathy pregnancy.
Solidarity. Yeah. Injury.
But you got to say pregnancy.
Oh, yeah. That makes it weird.
Oh, yeah, it was awkward. That made it awkward. Yeah, sorry, we should move on.
Yeah, we should just keep going.
Margot, what was the hardest part for you, like, other than doing everything we had to do, except you did it in heels?
Yeah, that was tricky. And I had less layers to hide, padding and stuff, doing stunts, so that made it a little painful. I thought I broke my rib at one point, but I actually just...
I
tore the muscles off the rib instead of breaking it, but it was fine. It was towards the end.
Planted coming off the chopper.
Oh my gosh, yeah. That hurt so much.
Middle of the take, there's like 50 extras, there's pyrotechnics. He's got up, knees raw, like palms bleeding.
I fell from like this high up, straight onto my knees on the bitumen. Yeah. It was so painful.
Then she stands up, I'm fine.
Yeah.
You can't cry in front of all those people. I was like, I'm good. I fell off a stage the other day in Toronto as well. Again, just popped up. I was like, that didn't hurt. And I was like,
just internal bleeding.
Yeah, crying on the inside. But the hardest part wasn't the physical side, actually. That was all, that's a mechanical side. And it's challenging, but it's rewarding and fun. And the emotional stuff was definitely more difficult, exposing my most vulnerable sides in front of a room full of strangers at that point. That was incredibly hard. Trying to figure out the dynamic between Harley and Joker and why she is so devoted to this guy that tries to kill her occasionally. I mean, it was like a few things like that. It took a while to get my head around, but the physical side was just more fun and challenging.
You guys keep bringing up the fact that, you did share so much stuff with each other. Which was harder for you, to keep the film secrets a secret or to keep the stuff that you guys shared with each other a secret?
Joel Kinnaman doesn't keep anything.
Yeah, there's no secrets Joel's here.
Yeah. He's just a soldier.
He's a soldier.
Soldier.
Yeah, Joel Kinnaman tells everything.
Everyone wants an interview with Joel.
He'll tell you the end of the movie right now.
He doesn't care. Just ask
him. It's great.
Awesome. So you guys are pretty tight-lipped with that answer. You're like, just ask Joel. Everything else is secret.
Yeah.
Who is our next question from right in the front?
Hi. Can you talk a little bit about bringing humanity and humor into all the mayhem for this?
Yeah, but David was really great because from the beginning, it was clear he wanted to do something different. He wanted to do something special. He wanted to make something that was something we'd all be really proud of. And I could get the sense from him that he was willing to go to all lengths in order to get that. And that was both a little scary, but also really exciting. And he's not only the director, but the writer of the film. And I was surprised by how much freedom he gave, I think, everybody to just go completely fucking crazy.
No, that was your experience.
And he was... but what I thought was really genius about David is he was always looking for the accident.
Yeah.
He was always looking for the mistake.
Yes.
And yeah, embracing yeah. that. And for Margot and I, there was a lot of humor. There was a lot of things that I thought were really funny in a very sick and twisted way. But he was really wonderful in that way. Thank you, David.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you, David.
Yeah, I was going to say, just when David and I first had a discussion, you know, and he presented Killer Croc with the prosthetics that were very extensive, my first question to him is anybody actually going to know I'm in there? And he said, absolutely, because he really wanted an actor that could bring the soul of the creatures to life. And I think with all of us, these are villains with souls. And I think that's indicative of his vision. And there's a beautiful moment in the movie where Killer Croc, where it's very easy to have a punchline that is ugly, but you know, he says, I'm beautiful. And it sends a statement when a crocodilian, reptilian, black man can say, I'm beautiful, about acceptance, you know? And I think in this kind of genre, that's very fearless and quite bold to make humane statements. So,
but he wasn't humane on set because when you go to his trailer, it was all about cannibalism. He's listening to cannibal chants on his phone. Yeah, yeah. So you go up to him and you go, "Hey, Adi," and he's like, "Wah."
Yeah. No, he took it very serious. Like he was watching crocodile videos of you know things and you know cannibalism and all that. And I think that as a cast, we have a question, and I think Adewale should answer this question honestly, once and for all.
Did you eat any
of your assistants? Because there was an assistant that came up missing. There was, he had an assistant, and it was the what was the guy's
Michael.
Name?
The young
guy. And you just once and for all, we all think you ate him. So we need to know.
I've got a surprise for you.
Yeah, we were.
I got a surprise for you. He's in your trailer, wrapped in a bow, with a big smile. No. But yeah, they're right. We all took our characters very seriously.
And I did eat mine.
Well, just to let you guys know, everybody asked, like, who was the guy that would kind of keep us together? And from my point of view, I saw Jai as our go-to guy to liven it up because Boomerang had this weird kind of, like, nature right from getting out of his bag, sack bag. But he really was... I thought the guy that really brought the crazy because he'd have to turn it up a notch.
He definitely brought the crazy.
I've done
love scenes in movies. I had quite a few movies where I've had really extensive love scenes, but I've never had a co-star that I've seen naked more than Jai. You know, it was like he had a really, really hard time keeping his clothes on set. He didn't feel a need.
There isn't a need.
Something interesting when I was on the set, I saw a photograph of a naked man running after David Ayer, who had a look of abject terror on his face and had perfect running form that you only see at the Olympics. I mean, the most aerodynamic form and a look of intense concentration.
He didn't
and then
get
there, I think it was a naked Jai maybe running
sure.
behind him.
I'm not sure.
Him.
We can't say for certain.
It's hard to see the pixels.
The story behind that picture, I'll never know, I don't think.
It was like a gazelle.
And it really was. It really was.
Did anybody know the person that kind of said sick him?
Yeah.
That was true story behind it is.
He'll show you everything.
I mean, there's not much more to it. David used to like to come and visit kind of the like base camp where our trailers all would be.
It was more like, just making sure nothing was on fire.
Yeah, every now and then he'd come and keep an eye on things, and but he would just open the trailer door and he'd be in the kind of in there like, what's up, dude? And this is one time I was like, I was getting out of the shower and he came in and I opened the doors, what's up, dude? And I was like, oh, what's up? And then I just, you know, it was an opportune moment. So I dropped the towel and went after him.
And Jay went, you sick em, boy.
And off they went around the whole studio parking lot. It was,
I never got him.
No. Can we start like an online poll or like a charity drive to release this photo? I think it'd be a good charity.
I mean, something
for the kids.
For the kids.
We'll talk about it. Put a black bar on it somewhere.
We can bar it. Yeah, sure, yeah. That's true. All right, yeah, let's work on that. It's up to David.
All right, who has our next question? In the back.
Hi. My name is Cynthia. I write for Black Girl Nerds. And hi, everybody. And this is a question for the women, Viola, Margot, Kara, Karen. One of the things that actors have to do is they have to find a way to connect with their characters or probably create a backstory for them, even though this was based on a comic book, so there's already a backstory. But what are some ways that you kind of tapped into playing your characters? And is there a way that you could identify playing these female characters, but not as badass or smart or strong, but maybe vulnerable and narcissistic or anything of that sort?
I did a lot of research. The thing I found really helpful for just filling in the gaps, because like you said, we had an amazing resource with the comic books, but there are still little gaps in the backstory and things you need to fill in yourself. And I watched a couple of TED Talks on schizophrenia, amongst like a bunch of other things, but that really helped because the women that were doing these talks were so intelligent. I mean, they were professors, they were, you know, and Harley needs to be wickedly intelligent, but also kind of psychotic. So I don't know, I found that, and you told me to go look at the TED Talk, but it was so helpful. And I also got recommended to read a play called Fool for Love, about this really dysfunctional relationship, and that, for whatever reason, helped me unlock the whole, you know, feeling towards the Joker. So yeah, it was things that, I don't know, some things hit home when you're doing all your research and some things kind of don't, but it's, yeah, that really helped.
I definitely want to know how you connected with that character.
Well, Joel gave me a book called Confessions of a Sociopath. And I read that book extensively. And one of the things, it's a confessions of a woman who's a sociopath. And one of the things I found out is a lot of CEOs of companies are sociopaths. Mm-hmm. People who have no guilt. If they cry, they're only crying because they feel like they're losing control. And I tapped into Viola at 8. Because I can't tap into Viola at 51. At 8, I could beat somebody's ass. And I could beat somebody's ass. I was just always angry because, you know, people were always teasing me. I was bullied. And I remember that was the first story I told David when I met him. He was like, oh, yeah, Viola, just tell me about your childhood. I said, well, David, I remember when I was 8 years old, I kicked a lot of ass. And so there was a part of me that had to tap into that, because with women, with me, I'm always apologizing. I'm shy, I'm always retreating, I never tap into my power, and Amanda Waller is not that. She is unapologetically brutal. Yep. And you know, because I had to call him a pussy a couple of times. But I had to tap into that, because otherwise I would have retreated. And with this group, I couldn't retreat. So that's what I did.
No, she did not retreat at all. There was no retreat. It was pretty much every day that me and Viola had together on set. She would, you know, David would call on her to, like, come and stand behind the camera. And then she'd stand behind the camera and just yell mean things at me. She'd be like, hey, Joel, flag. You little bitch. Punk ass bitch. And I said, oh, okay. All right. Good morning.
that was my experience.
But Croc liked it. He likes some Amanda Waller.
Yeah.
She was gutter.
I think what happens in film a lot is the male voices, and by voice I mean the character, the depth of the character, the performance, the way the character is resolved and executed, and the arc of the character is incredibly developed, and often the women are underdeveloped. And in this case, I wanted women that had voices and had power and were powerful as women. And you know, as a father of two daughters, I think it's important to give them examples that you can speak up in the world and you can have a viewpoint.
Hell yeah.
Wow, that's really sincere and sensitive of you.
Yeah. I don't like him seeing that side.
He never speaks like this to us.
Yeah. I've never seen that.
Never mind.
Yeah. What about for Karen and Kara?
You go, Karen.
Oh, shit.
You go, girl. Over to you.
You're gonna do great.
You're a pro at this. Shoot. Go, Kathy. For her question? Yeah. Well, coming from a Japanese-American family, we had a lot of those cultures and values, Japanese cultures and values, growing up in the household. You know, it was my first language, and we grew up on Japanese traditions and food and TV and all of that. So I think when I first read the Katana comics, I immediately fell in love, and I immediately felt like there was a part of her inside of me, even though our personalities were so completely different. And for me, the switch really happened when I put on the mask and the wardrobe, and that really helped me tap into the character.
Okay. So for me, some of the first things David said to me were about looking into things like addiction, trying to find, like, you know, never getting enough or never feeling like anything is enough and constantly needing something and that kind of thing. And then also it was trying to find the kind of opposites of her and also kind of trying to find a demon inside myself, which I definitely was able to find. And exercise. Yeah, that wasn't that hard. Just quite easy.
The surface.
Yeah.
Just right there.
A couple of inches under the surface.
It's right there. It wasn't too hard. So I had an easy job. And kind of trying to make that as real as possible and understand why someone would do something that evil or want to really hurt that many people and just trying to make it real, I guess, because I think that's what David wanted for this movie, and I think that's what he gave us and that's what I wanted to give.
I think we've got one more question in the audience.
Oh, yeah.
Right over here.
Hi, this question is for David. So this is one of the most diverse casts we've seen in a really long time. Yeah. And so... Which I think is like amazing, right? But that's just my personal opinion. But so when you were writing the film, when you were writing it, is this something you were thinking about or did it just happen like organically? Like were you like looking and you were saying Viola's Amanda Waller, which hell yes. But you know, were you thinking about any of that?
I mean, look, for me, you know, I grew up in South LA. I grew up in a really diverse neighborhood. I was the only white boy. That's how diverse it was. I mean, and you know, it's the world I know, it's the world I live in, but it's also the world we all live in. And I feel like on screen, you know, kids need to see people that look like them. Mm-hmm. You know, my wife is Latina, you know, my kids are Latino, so it's important for them to see faces like theirs on the screen. Mm-hmm. And this is also, it's a global business these days, and we need to evolve with the times. But, you know, it comes naturally to me, but I think, you know, that's, in diversity is strength, and we need to be a lot more inclusive in film. We really need to work on that, and in our world in general.
Yeah. All right.
So I love hearing what everybody had to say, and thank you guys so much for your questions. But I want to know too, just seeing all of the cast up here and hearing how you guys interact together for Charles and David and Richard, did you guys ever have moments on set where you were like, oh my God, what did we get ourselves into? How is this movie getting made?
I never felt that way at all.
What?
For me, it was like, I mean, look at this cast assembled up here and this great filmmaker. It's a producer's dream. It's the best way I could equate it is like being the manager of the All-Star team. You get to go to work every day, and you get to see the greatest actors in the world all collaborating together. So for me, it was a producer's dream, because you really are watching the best of the best go to work, and I couldn't ask for a better job.
Thank you.
And I would just echo that by also saying, you know, David took these great characters from the canon, the comics, and he wrote a great script that had great characterizations, and then we had this amazing group of actors actually really mine it and make it even better. So it was really a producer's dream. Not all the time in terms of getting them to get serious sometimes, but at the end, at the end of the day, watching the dailies, it couldn't have been better.
But also too, it's like working on films, if the guys on top aren't on our level as the actors, it's not gonna work. So to know that our leaders out there were setting up and making it that comfortable space, we wouldn't be who we are. So, you know, they're blowing it off too, like it's like, oh, no worries. But it comes from the top. You know?
So you're saying they were running around naked right next to them?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Chuck all the time. Chuck, yeah. Chuck all the time.
Yeah, that's the first time I see Chuck with clothes. The
trick is never show fear. They are many. I am one. You can never show fear, or they'll just turn on you. You know. And the other thing is always have an answer, even if you're just making it up and don't believe in what you're saying. Just pretend you know what you're doing, and they kind of will follow you.
Yeah. Now every once in a while we would look at David, and I'm like, hey man, you know you just made that up, right? You know that's not the real answer to the question. You just made it up,
and he would
just
give. He'd call me out. Yeah. And I'd be like, okay, is that light ready?
Yeah.
All right, you guys. Well, that's all the time that we have with them for right now. Huge thank you to the entire cast.